Hello, and welcome to another special edition of Up Close on METV. I'm Charles Clapsaddle, station manager for Manatee Educational Television. And it's our great pleasure to welcome back on Up Close Bill DeYoung, author, to talk about another one of his books, and it's quite the unique story. Bill, it's good to see you.
Hey, buddy.
I certainly enjoyed Skyway. The program that you did on the heels of the anniversary was a significant program. It's a significant book, and congratulations on that.
Thank you.
But today, you brought another one of your books.
Yes, I did.
And it's really a unique story.
It is. It's an unusual story and very different from Skyway.
Oh, very much different. And the name of the book is Phil Gernhard, Record Man.
Yeah.
And this is a unique Florida story, but even more so, it's a unique Sarasota story. So, first of all, who's Phil Gernhard?
Boy, you know, I get that a lot. Phil Gernhard was a very successful record producer who began in Florida, in his native Florida, in the 1960s, and through the 60s and 70s, had a lot of hit records, which I hope we get a chance to talk about today.
We bet.
And towards the end of his life, the last 30 years of his life, was the head of what they call Artists and Repertoire for Curb Records.
Wow.
In Los Angeles and Nashville, and was instrumental in launching Tim McGraw and Rodney Atkins, among others, to superstardom. And he's a Sarasota guy.
Yeah. Well, this is such a unique story, and you know, kind of want to take it chronologically. But first of all, how did you find out about Phil Gernhard?
I'm from St. Petersburg, and I was one of those kids who always read the labels on records.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, okay. I see you brought your records here today.
I did.
Yeah. And so I guess I always knew who he was. I was always fascinated by the record business, and when I was a music journalist for many, many years, and you can't help but, you know, look at the details, the fine print, as it were, as you're coming up through that. And I always knew that there was this guy who'd been from Sarasota and St. Pete and Tampa, where he did a lot of his work, who'd had a lot of hits with Florida artists, regional artists from this area. And so I always knew who he was. And when it occurred to me a couple of years ago, I don't know, whatever happened to that guy?
Who was that guy?
I went online and found out, sadly, that he committed suicide after a long and very, very successful career. And so I decided to work backwards and find out exactly who he was and how he accomplished all these things. It was very much for me about Florida history.
And it's very much, we're going to touch on some of that.
Yeah.
But you know, this was a unique young man. This was an individual, never went to school for, you know, music or the music business. Matter of fact, he was going to law school, is that correct?
Yeah, he went to University of South Carolina to study naval science.
Naval science?
Well, his dad had been a lieutenant in the Navy in World War II. His dad, who was a Sarasota County Commissioner, by the way, named Boyd Gernhard, rather strict man, and thought rock and roll was frivolous, you know, like a lot of people from that generation, I think. And so he basically made Phil go to college to be in the ROTC, and he was going to go into the Navy, which Phil didn't want to do. Then he discovered rock and roll and literally never looked back.
And you know, that's a unique thing. You know, coming from, you know, military families, you know, they try to impose their way of thinking on you, and it, sometimes it just doesn't match.
No.
But you know, this young man, he's at University of South Carolina, studying and trying to get on with his life. 19, 20 years old.
Yeah.
And he meets the writer-performer of this song. And tell us about that. And to this day, 56 years, this song is still a staple everywhere you go.
Well, we're talking about Stay.
Correct.
By Maurice Williams and the Zodiacs.
Yeah.
Which is
classic.
One of the great post-doo-wop R&B records. It was number one in 1960. Maurice Williams and the Zodiacs were popular, they're from South Carolina, and so Phil and his college roommate got to see them quite often and to know them. Now, in those days, people would make records on the fly, wherever somebody would come up with the money, you know, and so Maurice Williams and the Zodiacs, they were called the Gladiolas before that, and had a more catchy name, I guess. They had had, you know, some regional success with little records on other little fly-by-night labels. Phil and his roommate liked them so much, they came up with the money to, and they were ballsy enough to say, let's make a record with you. They never produced a record in their lives. Nobody knew how
to do that. They're 19, 20 years old.
Phil was 19 when they went in and started producing a couple of singles. And the third one was Stay, which Maurice Williams had written. They went directly to number one. Phil was 19 years old. And then he spent the next 3 years not going to class and producing with his partner a dozen or more records of different kinds. They did girl group records, they did R&B records, they did early rock and roll records, and none of them made a dent. All the Stay money ran out, and he came back to Florida. And that's when we pick up, you know, part two of Phil's story.
And, you know, the thing is, that, you know, and I can't emphasize enough, this is just a young man, loved music, wasn't a musician.
Couldn't carry
wasn't a businessman. He just recognized things that he thought were great, sounded great, and from that point, he just took off.
Phil used to tell his wife, Sandy, his first wife, who's a lovely person, that he wished he could insure his ears because he had a really good sense of what would sound great on the radio. And this is innate. You know, as you say, he didn't go to school to learn how to do that. He just made it up as he went along. He had quite a few records, as I said, that weren't successful. But when he got back to Tampa and St. Petersburg, he set up an office in St. Petersburg and was going to Stetson University Law School to please his dad, pretty much. He started recording the teen garage bands around Tampa, St. Petersburg, and would haunt the clubs and, you know, waiting for that song that he heard his for his ears to tell him that's a hit. He wanted it again, and he wanted it real bad.
Well, once I would think that, you know, you get bitten by the bug, you still want to stay in the game. You want to keep going.
Sure.
And you develop an ear, you develop an eye for, you know, the type of things. And he didn't have to really wait that long, because subsequent to Stay, which was huge and still played everywhere, He was introduced or met the Royal Guardsman.
Sure.
And the Royal Guardsman, I guess in the business you would call it a novelty song. Tell us about that.
Well, it's a great story, and it's an oft-told tale, but in very much like Skyway, I felt that I felt kind of honored to be able to root out the exact truth of this story and put it out there. The song, of course, is Snoopy versus the Red Baron.
It's a great song.
Which the Royal Guardsmen were a teen band from Ocala. They used to play in Tampa, St. Pete a lot when they were, you know, some of the guys were still in high school. In fact, I'll tell you this much, the photo on the back of their first record, three of the guys are wearing wigs because they couldn't have long hair in high school. That's how young they were. Snoopy versus the Red Baron had originated with a song that Phil's songwriting partner Dick Holler had come up with, and it was written very much, it was a Red Baron story, written very much like those old Johnny Horton records, if you remember the Battle of New Orleans, Sink the Bismarck.
It's telling a story.
Sure, it was an historical ballad, and it had that chorus 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 or more, the Bloody Red Baron was rolling up the score. It was a fairly serious song. Well, in 1966, Phil is in class at Stetson, kind of bored, didn't really want to be there, and he started remembering this song of Dick Holler's in the back of his mind. They'd tried to record it, and at the same time, Peanuts was happening.
It was huge.
It was huge, and this was the year that Snoopy was fighting the Red Baron from the top of his, you know,
doghouse,
the Sopwith Camel. And Phil, to amuse himself, wrote down what he could remember of Dick Holler's song about the Red Baron, including that chorus, and then started just making up more words about Snoopy. And that's how the song was born. And he knew, he said, wait a minute, this is a hit record. And he and Dick kind of sat down together and hammered it out. He brought it to every band that he worked with here, the tropics, the outsiders, the sugar beets, and none of them would do it. They all said, it's a little sappy.
Yeah.
It's a bubblegum tune. Well, the Royal Guardsmen thought it was kind of stupid, too, but Phil said, this is a sure hit record, and they went,
hit okay. record?
So they did it, yeah. So they recorded it.
And from that point, it just took off.
It sold 5 million records. It was number one in Australia for 13 weeks. It went around the world. It was a huge record. Now, he had to get Charles M. Schulz in on the finances.
Oh, I'm sure.
And Schulz, the way they hammered the deal out, made more money than Phil or Dick or the Royal Guardsmen combined. The record company made most of the money, of course.
Right.
And the Guardsmen, I still know these guys. And they ain't rich, let me put it that way.
But, I mean, excuse me for thinking, but didn't you say they just had a reunion?
Yeah, 2 weeks ago. It was in late April of 2018 that we got five of the six Guardsmen are still with us, and they did a reunion concert at the Palladium Theater in St. Petersburg, and we had a great time. And they still sound wonderful. They really do.
Well, and I'm saying you're a little bit older. I'm sure they don't have to wear wigs anymore. But the point is that, you know, that was a
There's a little less hair than there used to be.
That's true.
Yeah.
But I'm sure it's it's the shouted out. It's the most requested song when they do performances of that time. And, you know, that's great that after all this time, that song still has like a great resonance with audiences out there.
Well, you know, Phil, being no fool, had them do, over the course of 3 years, they did five Snoopy songs.
Oh, really?
Snoopy's Christmas is a huge one. Ah. They played that at the reunion concert, too. That was fun. They all wore little Santa caps, you know. They sound really good, too, by the way. We had great
And I think, and again, it goes back to, you know, Phil's ear for talent. He had the song, adapted the song, but then he found the right people.
Yeah.
Got that production sound going, and it was a huge hit.
It's a great little single. I mean, granted, it's a novelty record.
Sure.
But it still sounds good today. And we should stress that record that everybody in the world knows was recorded on a little four-track studio on MacDill in Tampa.
And that's, you know, then, you know, people will think when they're recording now, you're doing, you know, 20 tracks, you've got, you know,
yeah.
But, you know, in that day when, you know, the business was just beginning and stuff, you know, there were four-track studios. You'd go in, you'd do two mics, and that would be it.
Mm-hmm. And so, definitely held up.
Well, one of the things, and I think you hit the nail on the head when you said, I wish he had his ears insured.
Mm-hmm.
He did have an ear for music. A wide variety of music, which brings us to what I think is probably one of the best songs that, you know, he produced,
mm-hmm.
and that's Abraham, Martin, and John.
It's a classic.
It's
sure.
a classic song. It has meaning. It's emotional. It means something to people when mm-hmm. they hear that. And but this came about in kind of a strange way too. Tell us that story.
Well, it was written by Dick Holler, who mm-hmm. had written The Red Baron. And which became Snoopy versus the Red Baron. And when that record hit, Phil started his little company in St. Petersburg, and Dick came as his staff songwriter. And they produced the Royal Guardsmen albums together.
Mm-hmm.
They happened to be in New York City in June of 1968, putting the finishing touches on what turned out to be the last Royal Guardsmen album, when news came in that Robert Kennedy had been assassinated. And this is just a month after the assassination of Martin Luther King. They immediately stopped the session. Dick Holler, God love him, told me this entire story, how this happened. They flew back to St. Petersburg, and their first day back in the office after not doing anything for a couple of days, he went to his piano in the back office to spin it upright, and he wrote Abraham, Martin, and John in 15 minutes.
No kidding.
Just poured out of him. Written in St. Petersburg, yeah. One of the most famous songs in history, yeah.
And it truly is a great story.
Yeah.
But again, Phil Gernhard was there, you know, all
sure.
along shepherding that project simply because he knew the sound, the emphasis that he wanted to play.
He had dozens of singers audition that song for him.
Oh, I can only imagine.
Including Barry Winslow from the Royal Guardsmen. It also became a Royal Guardsmen record, which would have been great. Eventually, they ended up with Dion, the former doo-wop singer.
Which is Dion was a teen heartbeat. You know, had his records. You know, selecting Dion, you know, from Phil's standpoint, pretty brave choice.
It had to do with Dion's record company, which was the same record company that the Royal Guardsmen were on, and the president of the record company said, Phil, will you just go listen to him? DeYoung was living in South Florida and had just gone through some hard times in his life and was kind of reinventing himself as an acoustic folk singer. And so they did. Dick and Phil went down to listen to him, and they realized that what he was doing was perfect for this song. And so they convinced him to come to New York, and they cut Abraham Martin and John in a single take.
Wow.
Yeah.
One take. It's pretty amazing.
Yeah.
I mean, but you need to developing the song, writing the song, finding the right people to do that, and then getting that out. It's an amazing task. You
got
to remember that he's still a relatively young guy.
Sure, yeah.
New to the business, new to all
he
the
he wasn't even
trapdoors.
He was even 30 yet, but maybe just approaching 30. But the interesting thing there is. Well, actually, I forgot what I was going to say, but I'll think about it later.
I'm sure it'll be a lot of interesting stuff you're talking about. But, you know, one of the great things that after Abraham Martin and John came out, Phil, you know, had a lot more credibility. He had
yeah.
a lot more, you know.
That's exactly
because,
right,
yeah. you know, he developed this talent. He had an ear for it. People were starting to notice that this guy is not only did, you know, Snoopy versus the Red Baron, but, you know, he's got this Abraham Martin and John. He started off with Stay. So,
yeah.
you know, his credibility and place in the business is really getting solidified. So people are looking for him now
mm-hmm.
to help produce their record.
That's exactly
And one
right.
of the great things, which I think, which is, as you said at the very beginning, this is a unique Florida, Sarasota story. He's kind of stayed for the most part of his life in Florida with Florida artists doing, you know, helping them, you know, develop their records. And the next one that comes to mind is Lobo,
right.
which, again, I don't know if you call it a novelty song, but it's a Me and You and a Dog Named Boo.
Yeah.
I mean, that was a huge hit, too.
It was a huge hit. Lobo is Kent Lavoie, who mm-hmm. was from Winter Haven. Kent had been the lead singer in the Sugar Beats, which was the first record that Phil did. A teen record. It sold about 400 copies off WLCY in Tampa back in 65. And Kent was still writing songs, and he came up with this song, Me and You and a Dog Named Boo. And Phil literally stopped and said, well, that's a hit. Yeah. It's important to remember that he was producing a lot of records locally, not a lot, you know, maybe two or three a year that didn't do anything.
Right.
But he was trying. Some of them are really, really good. Some of them not so good, you know. But you
that's
know,
the business.
That's the business. But this song he knew is a hit. And he got it lined up with another label that had just opened out in New York and L.A. And that was a huge hit. And Kent, and he stayed in Florida. First of all, he was still going to Stetson. It didn't last very long, and he didn't graduate. Mm. But he was married, and he had a family here. He was promoting concerts in Tampa, St. Pete. Mm. You should know that Phil Gernhardt brought Jimi Hendrix to this area twice. The first and only times Hendrix ever played here were Gernhardt shows. Janis Joplin for the only time she played here. Wasn't the only time, but it was last time. She was arrested for using foul language at a Gernhardt show. It's a famous story. You can see her mugshots online.
I didn't know that.
And Gernhardt bailed her out of jail. Eric Clapton and Derek and the Dominoes played here exactly one time with Dwayne Allman, which is an historic show, and that was a Phil Gernhardt show. Elton John, the first time he played here. So he was
That's amazing.
Active in the community.
It's amazing. I think too, the Florida emphasis kind of lends him that credibility with other Florida artists. Because, you know, he started to develop people, you know, find things. And the ones that come to mind are Jim Stafford and the Bellamy Brothers.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, both well-known artists, really appreciative, had a great fan following.
Yeah.
And he developed music for them.
He did. Stafford was from Winter Haven also. He'd gone to high school with Kent Lavoie. So Kent was Stafford's entree into the world of Phil Gernhardt because they
right.
knew each other. And Stafford's big hit was called Spiders and Snakes,
right. yeah.
which had been originally written by this kid from Pasco County named David Bellamy. That came as a demo. Phil thought it was stupid. Stafford loved it and rewrote
Took
it.
On.
And it was a huge hit. And that brought David Bellamy and his older brother Howard into the orbit, and Phil found the song Let Your Love Flow.
Which, again, major hit.
Yeah, it was number one.
And you know, to this day, it's another one of those songs that still has, you know, legs on it that, you know, people like to hear at parties and events and whatnot.
Mike Curb.
Way after the fact.
Who is, you know, something of a legend in the music
business. Absolutely.
told me that Let Your Love Flow in Phil Gernhardt's production, he says that's one of the best produced records of all time. Byron Gallimore, who is a very famous Grammy-winning producer from Nashville, he's Tim McGraw's producer, also said the same thing. He said, when I met Phil Gernhardt, I was very nervous because Let Your Love Flow is one of the greatest things. It's a great 3-minute production, mm-hmm. and there's an art to that. And Phil knew how to do that.
And you know, working with, you know, sound designers and production engineers is true. But, you know, behind all of that is the producer who says, I need this, I want that, this is how it's got to flow. And again, back to that ear, back to that, you know, sense of, you know, what works and what doesn't mm-hmm. work. It's really amazing. But here he is, he's accumulated over this period of time this success. And not everyone's a hit, that's the business.
Yeah. Lobo had a good run.
Lobo had a good run.
I'd Love You to Want Me was, I think, an even bigger hit than Me and You and a Dog Named Boo. Stafford had Swamp Witch and My Girl Bill.
Oh, yeah.
Personal favorite of mine. And Wildwood Weed. You know, they're all novelty songs, but they were huge hits.
And again, you know, those are the type of things that people recognize to this day, you know, years and years after the thing.
Sure.
But, you know, Gernhardt continued to do, you know, the affiliation with Mike Curb. Mm-hmm. And in the business, you know, it wasn't much bigger than Mike Curb.
Sure. Well, Mike Curb had been the young president of MGM Records in the early 70s, which is how Phil met him, got Stafford involved with him, and they kind of formed an alliance. And through the 70s, before Curb started his label, he was working with various labels and various affiliations. He was also lieutenant governor of California in this period of time.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Phil was always his lieutenant, under Jerry Brown.
No kidding.
Yeah, absolutely. Phil was kind of his lieutenant, and Phil produced for Mike Hank Williams Jr.
Mm-hmm.
None of the hits, but some good stuff.
Mm-hmm.
He produced the first records for Deborah Allen and for James House.
Wow.
He produced Petula Clark, all for Mike Curb. And at the end of a certain period, he stopped producing and went into what we call A&R work. Mm. Which is basically he would pair artists with songs and work kind of tirelessly. He still knew how to craft it, but he left the production to other people. And so therefore, he was instrumental in the astronomical success of Tim McGraw and Rodney Atkins and Joe DiMessina and people on Curb Records.
And you know, very popular, dedicated musicians, talented musicians, you know, that here is this guy from Sarasota, Florida, you know, in the forefront of making all of this happen.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, very successful, you know, I mean, he went from moderate to, you know, very successful thing. But it wasn't always, you know, music and a good vibe for Phil, was it?
Wow.
He went through, there were some serious, whether it was the business or the personality, but he had some issues.
There's a famous saying in the music business that the music business eats its young. And what I came to find out was that on a personal level, Phil self-destructed. I think it finally just consumed him. I mean, he was a prodigious drug taker. He was an alcoholic, and every artist that I spoke with when I wrote this book, and I spoke to a lot of them, including Mike Curb, I had hours worth of conversations.
That's great.
They were very honest about Phil's addictions, and he was married and divorced 4 times.
And I think that's kind of indicative of, you know, and you know, there comes a lot of insecurities and anxieties and stress and all of the in the business, you know, and that kind of manifests itself in your life unless you're, you know, kind of stable enough to, you know, be able to handle it. But you know, as he went through, he continued to make music. He didn't stop. He continued to, you know, to put his best efforts into everything that he undertook.
What happened to Phil over time was his personal life kind of became his professional life too. In other words, he would take 6-month sabbaticals from Curb Records where nobody would see him.
Yeah.
Nobody would see him. And Mike knew that he was in rehab. Or that, you know, he was just on an island somewhere just trying
to get
it. It was very sad, but Mike Curb loved him. And people, Curb says in the book, people would ask me all the time, how long are you going to keep working with this guy? And he says, Phil's always going to be working with us.
Well, the thing is that, too, he had the talent, he had the ear, he had the, you know, the drive and the ambition to do that. And, you know, and I would think, and I would defer to you on that, but every time that, you know, he had a hit, it had to run him up the flagpole. He had to be, you know, over the moon.
Oh, sure.
Every time something, you know, whenever he heard something and it became that hit, it was a good thing for him.
It would certainly feed, you know, it would feed the coffers, obviously, but it would feed the ego, and it would feed his sense of, yes, I'm on the right track. Mm. You know, he went to the 70s, you couldn't stop this guy. You know, when he actually left Florida, I would say, in around 74 for L.A. when he worked with Curb. And
then he ended up in Nashville for a
while. Yeah, well, Curb relocated to Nashville and became a country music label. And yeah, well, so he lived there, and that's where he died.
The thing that I admire about your book, Bill, is the fact this is really a local story. Mm. This is a local kid. You know, grew up in Sarasota, you know, and that from that point on, it's one of those backstories you don't hear a lot about.
Yeah.
But when you start hearing what he did with music, the artists that he represented, and the quality of the programs that he did, this is something very unique for Sarasota. Sarasota's got a very active music business now. I imagine what Phil would do if he was around today with the music scene.
Oh my gosh, I'm not entirely sure that he'd be able to function in today's music business. I know it kind of makes me nuts. It's just, you know, you kind of pine for the old days, but then you realize that time marches on and, you know, progress goes on, and it's not organic the way it used to be.
Right.
You know, but I mean, who am I to say that's wrong?
Well, you know, you've seen the thing too. As a longtime music, recognized music journalist, you've seen the changes that have been made in music and produced.
Oh yeah.
I would think too, wasn't that easy to get something produced then? You know, to the quality and caliber, you know, to do. But you know, Phil had this like drive. You know, he had a little drive. He had a lot of ambition. You know, to try to get through this. So, what do you want people to take away from this book?
Well, I have to agree with you that the local kind of angle of this is very significant. You know, I think Florida doesn't often get its due, especially with regard to music history. Everybody knows the famous artists who came from Florida, but there are quite a few. I do a PowerPoint program that I do when I do my talks and things about. I called
you
it.
You know who this guy is? Who's this?
Yeah,
person?
I called it Florida's Top 40.
Okay.
So I limited it to 40. Actually, it goes to about 44. But and I talk about, and Phil's in there obviously, and Lobo and Stafford and all those people. But there are quite a few people that I think don't know the great saxophone player Cannonball Adderley, who played with Miles Davis on Kinda Blue, was from Tampa.
No kidding.
You know, there's some amazing stories, and that for me is an important takeaway.
And I would say, just like, you know, as you did so skillfully in Skyfall.
That's James Bond, remember?
Know,
Skyfall.
Yeah. As you did in Skyway, you really bring a sense of history. A sense of focus and a sense of, you know, the sequence and the importance of the sequence of events. And I would suggest, you know, just as we did as I suggested in Skyway, people pick up a copy. This is a great story. People our age, and not giving anything away, recognize every single one of these songs. You grew up listening to them in the background, the soundtrack of your life.
You know, for me, it was a lot like Skyway. It was just a story that I thought at least needed to be written down somewhere.
You know,
for if somebody says, well, wait a minute, there was a Florida connection to that? Or what really went down with regard to the Skyway Bridge? What was the real story there? There's now a place you can go to find it. You know, and that was important to me. I know that I would have liked to have read this.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was curious. It all just starts with curiosity.
But, and you've got this long history of a music journalist as well. So, you know, I can imagine when you started picking up things and this piqued your interest, and the more you got into it and the deep research and interviews that you did, this was something you're telling a story, a wonderful story.
Absolutely.
So what's next for you, Bill? You've got the bridge. You've got this great story about an individual who made music happen here in Sarasota. What's next for you? What do you got on the horizon?
I don't know, Charles. I don't know. I have a couple of things I'm working on. I'm writing an autobiographical thing that probably will never get published, but I felt like I needed to do it.
Good for you.
There's a big anniversary for me personally this year, which, you know, is neither here nor there, I suppose, to most folks. I have something about John Lennon and Paul McCartney I've been thinking about writing. And if I, you know, get my nerve up, I'll dive into that.
That'd be great.
There's more Florida stories out there to be told, obviously.
There's a ton of Florida stories out there, and I think you really have the ability to capture that Florida, not only history, but the feeling.
I'm a Floridian, man. That's what it's about.
It works like a dream.
That's where it comes from.
I'm just saying, whenever that gets done, whatever it may be, we'd invite you back in a heartbeat to come and talk about this book or any of your other books as well. But I'm just saying, it was a real pleasure. Both of your books are great, and I would encourage people. We're going to put your website up on the screen, so if people want to buy it, or they can go to Amazon, I'm sure, or whatever. Yeah. These are wonderful stories, wonderful, and you got some great little anecdotes in Record Man, too. There's some great little things. And, unfortunately, Mr. Gernhard, passed on, through his own hand. But, the thing was is that it's unfortunate.
Well, the legacy is there.
Right, exactly.
You can't deny it. You can't deny what he accomplished during his lifetime. And I think as all Floridians, we should know about it. And we have a reason to be proud of it. I'm proud of what he did. I wish I'd known him.
Well, I'm saying the next time you hear Stay on the radio or your thing, you'll know the story behind that and who brought that for everyone to hear.
Absolutely.
Bill, it's always a pleasure to see you, young man.
Once again, sir.
Thank you very much for joining us.
Thanks
and we
for
encourage
having us.
People to go out not only to get Skyway, but also to get Phil Gernhard, Record Man. Thanks, Bill, for joining. We'll look forward to seeing you next time.
Thanks, Charles.
And thank you for joining us on this special edition of Up Close on METV. Go to the website and order a book. All right, thank you, and we'll see you next time on Up Close.